Good afternoon, everybody. This is so important right now. My name is Michelle Morgan Trevilian, and I am so excited about today. Aren't all of you? Yes. Let's give this man a hand for what we're about to receive. So first of all, I want to talk about why a day like this is so important. It's important because as athletes and being a former athlete myself, right, Michelle? That's right, track girls. that's right, track girls, yes. And we know how hard practices are out in the sun, and we know as athletes that we always want the love of our hometown, and to be recognized by your hometown is such an honor, it's such a privilege, and it makes you feel like all those days that when you don't want to go to practice, your friend's going to do something fun, and you go, oh, I can't go, I got to go to practice. They going here, and you go, I can't go, I got a game. Or they're doing this and that, and you got to go and handle your business. The payoff of that is having a day like this right now, though, where your city, your mayor honors you, and especially this wouldn't be happening probably if we didn't have the kind of mayor that we have in the city that recognizes athletes like that, Mayor Raz J. Baraka. So with that being said, one of those coaches who we know coaches are like the second parents. They teach you discipline. They teach you love. They teach you how to handle life, not only in your particular sport, but also how to handle life. Like, because I know some of y'all go there, coach, I need money for a haircut because I got to go to the prom. Or, coach, what had happened was I need books. I need this. I need that. And your coaches are there, right? Coaches, can I get an amen from the coaches? So without further ado, I'm going to have one of those coaches that coached this wonderful man we are honoring today, Mr. Al-Qadim Muhammad. And one of those coaches who inspired him is the director of Recreation, Cultural Affairs, and Senior Services, Mr. Donnell Redding.
Well, thank you so very much, Ms. Michelle. I want to say thank you, Mayor, for making this a special day for Brother Al-Qadim, which is our hometown hero. And I want to say this, I want to just give you two little short stories about this young man, right? Which exemplify his humility, toughness, his ability to be attentive, and his intellect. So I just want to start with that. Because I remember when I first met this young man, I really thought he was a young man, actually. He was like 13 or 12 years old. I seen him come through the park, and I was asking the coaches, who is that? They was like, that's Al-Qadim Muhammad. I'm like, and? Do he got a birth certificate? If you'd have seen the size of this guy, right, because he was bigger than me, taller than me, and I was like, wow. I said, you actually going to play for us? He said, yes, I'm going to actually play for you. So I'm an offensive coach, right? So I love offense. He is a defensive specialist at 13 years of age. So I said, you know what? You're not going to play defense for me. You're going to play wing back because we ran a wishbone offense. So I put him at the wing back. And to see him turn the corner, sweep the corner, take on cornerbacks, take on defensive ends, take on linebackers, and also hit the A and B gap, which is the 1 and 2 hole for all the enthusiasms in here, right? And actually to come up against a linebacker and then just like walk him in his chest. I want to say that's one thing nobody knew about him. He's a running back too. So I don't know why the NFL didn't put him in two positions, but he got two. I'm just going to end with this. I know we was doing a COVID. We was doing the virtual recreation. Yes, COVID was going on, but recreation still had to go on. Because the mayor said it must continue. So we given our introductions and running and doing our drills. And after that, all was over. I was tired. I sat down. And lo and behold, the brother sitting in the stands right now, Coach Nasir Gaines and Brother Ahmed Dadel from JFK, came up to me and started talking about my sneakers. Lo and behold, I didn't know they wasn't Jordans. Coach Nas came up to me and said, hey, those are not Jordan. Those are Marcus Jordans. Those are Jordan Cousins sneakers. And then I had Brother Dadell say, hey, no matter of fact, no. Those Jordans 0.5. So I said, oh, man, wow. Lo and behold, Coach Nas gave me the phone. And guess who's on the phone? Al-Qaeda Muhammad. I said, Al-Qaeda, what's going on? Coach D, you all right? Yeah, I'm all right. I'll get you a whole closet full of sneakers. I said, no, you don't have to do that. I'm good. You sure? I said, yeah. But that's just the heart in this young man, right? And the humility that he actually inserts. So at the end of all, I want to say congratulations to you. And also, I just want you to let you know that if you think I didn't know, he was laughing the hardest. Hey, congratulations. God bless you. It's always great to honor our hometown hero. Thank you.
All right, so moving on. Next up, we have another coach that was in Gal Claudine's life. And with saying that, you know that many times in life that we have to multitask and have several hats that we have to wear. We are mom, we're a dad, we're a mayor, we're a teacher, we're a councilman, which I want to recognize Councilman Patrick Council right here in the front row, South Ward Councilman. And we also have an assemblyman. This is his coach, Benji Wimberly, Al-Qaeda's former coach. Can you come up and speak now?
Good afternoon. So, Mayor, Councilman Council, all the elected officials, Mom, in 2009, I was the head coach at Patterson Catholic. And around 2005, we started a pipeline, Mayor, before they knew it, from Newark and Essex County to Patterson. And they used to say, Nas, you would get appreciate this. I would come to Little League games in my gear, 15 deep to football games, scooping kids up from Essex County. And I said, this is the biggest hidden gem you could find to do. And people like here, I said, I knew they were good because we used to go to youth games when Coach Councilman was there. And I used to watch the North kids and go, they different. And in 2009, Coach Nazir Gaines calls me up and goes, I have a kid for you. I go, Nas, we're leaving for camp tomorrow. And he brings him in and he walks in. All I see is this lanky kid with this thick neck. And I go, we gotta make this work. I left the field. I went inside to the administration. I said, look, I gotta get this kid registered today because we're leaving tomorrow. And Mom knows the story. We took care of everything. I called up one of our donors. I said, listen, his name was Joe Taub. He was part owner of the Nets and ADP and things. I said, Mr. Taub, I got a kid who's probably going to go to the NFL. I need help. And he goes, if you believe in him, we're going to get it done. And we got him there. And as a freshman, Quan led the county in sacks as a freshman. And also, I'm in an argument in the All-County. They didn't vote him first-team All-County. I said, he led the county in sacks. How can he be first-team All-County? They didn't give it to him. I said, that's fine. He's going to be okay. But I knew from that point on that this kid was special. And thanks to, Coach Nas and the Essex County Connection, that Patterson bond has always been here with football and sports. We made a run of 70-3 during that period of time and won, I think, 7 state championships. And during that time, Quan's senior year, we went 11-0 and gave up 43 points for the whole season. You heard what I said, 43 points for the whole season. And it was with guys like him and G5, Greg Moore, and that whole Eddie Ratcher, who's a cop now here in Newark, and these guys. And the one thing said, what was different about the Newark kids? I said, when you combine Patterson and Newark, I have pit bulls and Rottweilers together. And we took no prisoners at all. But more importantly, even after Patterson Catholic closed, we remained close. I remember Mr. Taub saying, if that kid is the real deal, make sure he's good. And for his time at Don Bosco, Coach Morangi can appreciate that. I would come up there and make sure all my Patterson guys were good at Don Bosco. And then when he went to Miami, Quan stayed on the phone. We made sure Quan was always good. But more importantly, what he's given back to Newark community and even kids from Patterson who still know who Quan is. That is the most important thing that I could see. A couple of months ago, I went out to LA and got a chance to hang out with him. And all I could think about is this kid who I used to drop off in the South Ward when they missed that bus in the morning. I have to go pick him up to come get him. And all I can see is like, man, this is God's plan for this man. And what he has done for not only Newark, his community, and his family, I could not be any prouder because I know the best is yet to come. So, Quan, congratulations. And it is really our honor.
All right. Okay, so next up, I have to give a shout out because none of us would be here, not even him, if we didn't recognize the queen who birthed him. Could everybody put your hands together, stand up for his mom, Michelle Epps. Please, yes. Now we know the family plays an important role in your life, both the men and the women in your life. So I'm going to introduce another woman who had a lot to say about Al Quadeen and his life at 13th Avenue School. Please welcome Miss Iris Matthew.
Good afternoon. Yes, have my papers. Yes, I'm a teacher. Because one of the things was, when I was asked to do this by, I call him Al, some call him Quan. I said, well, you better write something down because I could go on and on and on. I'm his teacher, but lately, in the last years, I am his godmother. Because the love that we have needed another kind of name. And God sent him to me through Michelle. I love you, Michelle. But this goes back to when he was in the kindergarten. We represent Al's teachers and supporters from the Pride of Newark, 13th Avenue School. Yes. Will the pride stand up? All the pride in here. Stand up. Yes. And give Al Quadeen. Yes, Nasir went to the pride as well. It is a with profound respect to the mayor, city council, and other city administrators that we are here to honor Al Quadeen Muhammad today. And for that privilege, Mayor, we thank you. To Michelle and the family, thank you for sharing Al Quadeen with me. It is a privilege to represent his first educational and nurturing people at 13th Avenue School. We were charged with educating and nurturing Al Quadeen, and there were days when that was quite a challenge. But we all saw that spark of greatness in him. And so we worked dutifully to help him to discover who he was. He was gifted, intelligent, kind, creative, charismatic young man. There were days when he didn't see that greatness in himself. And so he would end up with me. Now, I wasn't actually his classroom teacher. I was the behavior modification person for the school. So he was with me. But the bond that we created was so good that there were times when I was reported to the principal for having Al Quadeen in my office, and he hadn't even done anything. But that was because he wanted to just be nurtured and loved and cared for, and I didn't send him back all the time. And so I got in a little trouble myself. But our bond was so tight that after he left 13th Avenue School, he would come back every day. He lived in Irvington, and he would come all the way back, and I would take him home, and we'd end up going out for dinner and different things. And he would talk to me about his love for athletics, and especially football. It has been a journey of joy to witness the development of my beloved godson into this awesome man that we honor here today. It is said that when you show appreciation or give honor to others, the receiver gets blessed, the giver gets blessed, and everyone around to witness it gets blessed. So we here today are blessed. Am I right? Yes. Thank you, Mayor Baraka, for this prestigious honor that you bestow on our beloved Al Quadeen. And to my 6'4" baby, thank you for being the amazing man that you are and making a difference in my life. There are things I could tell you that he's done for me that will just stay between he and I, but trust and believe, he has blessed me beyond measure. And he's blessed all of you as well, I know. That's why you sit here today. And Al, you will go on to bless the world. I love you.
Okay, all right, moving on right along. One more thing, can the family stand up? Teresa, Jackie, stand up, Tahira? Yes. My little brother, recognize the family, because the family is the support system, the family. Okay, all right, thank you. Okay, so next up, we have the best mayor that we've ever had in the city of Newark, in my opinion. The next governor, too, if we are making history, being a Newark-born person here. We will have the mayor, the Honorable Mayor Raz J. Baraka.
This is what everybody's been waiting for. First, I want to obviously thank his family, his mother. You probably don't get all of the credit that you deserve. It's difficult raising black boys in cities like Newark. And you pray and you hope every day that everything you poured into them on good days and bad days, that it turns out to be something incredible. And so this is obvious that it has. And you know, I know you as a teacher, not as a track star. That's right. So, I mean, you know, Newark is a large but small family. And we cross paths here and there. I also want to thank all of the coaches that are here. I see Brian Logan, I see Mark over there, Nas, all of the folks that are here that coach, all of the kids from the high schools that are here. I'm glad we thought it not robbery and fit to bring these kids out, because they need to see what an end product could look like in terms of the work and the effort that you put in. And no matter where you're from, that this could be you on this stage one day as well. There's a lot of distractions that go on in your life, a lot of things that happen in and around here, a lot of people that you know, say that they're helping you, but really trying to help themselves. You know, but if you steer right and stay focused, if you keep your eyes on the prize and commit yourself to this now, this could be you. It's not easy. If it was easy, we'd be giving keys out every day to athletes all the time. So obviously the work that Al-Qaeda did is difficult, and he put in the work and he deserves it. So not only did he go to the NFL, but he also returns to Newark. And that's the important thing. That's why we're actually sitting here today, because he could have went to the NFL. We never seen him again. And then, you know, somewhere else people say, oh, yeah, he used to be from Newark or something like that. You know, there's some athletes that are like that. You know, they're from Newark. They're from Newark on occasion. There's some people I'll be like, yeah, he really from Newark. Al-Qaeda is one of those people. He's really, if you went to 13th Avenue School, you're really from Newark. But but at the end of the day, him coming back, mentoring kids and creating camps and being a part of what we're doing all the time, always keeping in touch with us here in City Hall, trying to make sure he's involved and engaged in what's going on in the city is incredible. We don't have to chase him down or ask him or find him. He shows up when the time is right and lends his hand and his support to what's going on in this town. You know, because he recognizes that the streets he was born and raised in, the things that were going on in his life is what produced him, right? Not just the skill and the talent, but even the obstacles that you have to overcome is what make you. Everything that you go through, you take with you. So even the bad days can turn into good ones, right? Even the difficult times that you went through, you can use those moments in times like this to prepare you for the things that lie ahead. I know the issues that you go through in the NFL ain't nothing compared to the issues that you went through growing up in the city of Newark and in this area in Essex County, or nothing you went through in high school or trying to make it there, right? And so you deserve a key. And I want to say, when we talked about it, I was like, definitely, without hesitation. I know a lot of people want to ask why, and they question why you want to do this, so forth and so on. We spend a lot of money in Newark and a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of effort, and there's a lot of press going back and forth about kids who get in trouble and about our ability to take care of kids who get in trouble. Who shot who robbed who got in trouble, our RLS, this place, that thing. Always us having discussion and money and print hours and things about somebody who's dead on the street somewhere, right? Or somebody who did something they have no business doing, right? We do not spend a lot of energy and time and print and media talking about our kids who got to the top of the mountain against all odds, who actually won, who at the end of the story defeated Goliath, right, with a rock and a slingshot. So we appreciate that. And so I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to give this brother the key to the city. If I can open it, here we go. If I could give you to the key to the city, and said, presented to NFL football player Al-Qaeda Muhammad by Mayor Raj J. Baraka, July 12th, 2024, the key to the city.
I'm gonna try not to get emotional. I think I done cried enough of it. First and foremost, I wanna thank God. I wanna thank my mom. I wanna thank my son. I wanna thank Raz And I want to thank the city of Newark. I want to thank all my coaches. I want to thank all my teachers that came out. I'm actually looking into the crowd. And Ms. Mosby, thank you for that penmanship. She told me how to write cursive. And, you know, some of these kids don't even know how to write cursive. But sometimes I think my cursive writing was great. Sometimes it wasn't. I think some, but she kept letting me write cursive, so I appreciate it. Wow. I just want to thank everybody that's here today, because without you guys, I wouldn't be me. And growing up in Newark, it takes a lot of people. It takes a village. It takes everybody, you know. And me growing up in Newark and, you know, going to college and going off to the NFL, all that was easy. You know, I think Newark, my coaches, my teachers, y'all prepared me for any obstacle or anything I was going to ever face in life. So me sitting up here getting emotional, I was emotional because I'm like, wow, you know, you don't realize, when you're younger, you don't realize, you know, that all these things you would need going through life. You don't even think that you're gonna fall back or rely on some of those principles and some of the things that your teachers, your parents, and all the different leaders and mentors that you cross paths with. You know, you don't know that you're gonna rely and fall back on those principles and those things. So I'm just like, wow, I'm blessed, I'm truly blessed, I'm truly honored, and I'm truly thankful, you know, because again, without you guys, I wouldn't be me. I wrote all this stuff, and after everybody got up and spoke, I said, you know what, I don't need this phone, I don't need these notes, I don't need none of it, you know. I want to thank my aunts, you know, they sitting up in the front, because my mom and my aunts was like Bonnie and Clyde. You know, they pretty much, you know, they always made sure I had whatever I needed, and I always had an expensive taste. I liked the finer things, and they made it happen. So thank you guys. I would like to thank my son, who's sitting in the front, because I had my son in high school at a young age, and to be honest, I knew I was going pro. I knew I was going to the NFL. I knew everything that's going on. I mean, everything that I accomplished and still accomplishing, I already knew that I was going to accomplish those things, because you was all the motivation I needed. You know? And it's funny because I'm in the NFL, and you would think that sometimes, you know, I don't really need motivation and, you know, push and words of encouragement from a 12-year-old. And it means the world to me when you tell me the things that you tell me, and it's not scripted, it's just who he is as a young man. And I truly thank you for just always, you know, wanting to know, Dad, what's next? What business ventures you involved in? What's this? What's that? You gonna play next year? You gonna do this? You gonna do that? And to be honest, I had thoughts of, you know, leaving the game and retiring and stuff like that, because I'm bigger than just football. And, you know, I got a lot of great things going on off the field. So it's great, but at this point in my life, I don't really need it. So, but when my son, you know, he looks up to me and he want to do everything I want to do, and he want to be just like me. And some of the things that he say to me on the car rides to working out and training and stuff like that, I say, I ain't got no choice but to do it. So without you, you know, I wouldn't be probably playing this season. So I appreciate you for just being you and asking me all the questions you asking me, listening to me and just always having my best interests at heart. You my best friend, you my son, and you know, just you my best friend, you my son, and you know, I feel personally inside, you know, I need God and I need you. So just keep being you and keep being, you know, close to me and next to me, and also keep being the great student you are, the great son you are, and just always having a mind of your own. Last but not least, I see a lot of young athletes in here. I see a lot of young student athletes first that has some bright futures. So I wanted to give you guys some words of encouragement and some words that whatever you want to do in life, you could do. You could be whatever you want to be. And, you know, there's some principles and some things that I live by that have helped me outside of all the beautiful people in this crowd, and even some people that's not here, coaches, mentors, and so on and so forth, you know, that could help you guys, like, be successful. You know, you could do whatever you want to do. You got to be consistent, and I truly believe that you are what you repeatedly do. If you repeatedly get good grades, you're a scholar. If you repeatedly go train and be great at, you know, working on your technique and perfecting your craft, you're gonna be a great football player. But you can't be a great football player if you're not doing the right things in school. School come first, you know. You gotta take tests, you gotta do different things to accept those scholarship offers, you know. And so you gotta do the right thing. It go hand in hand. You can't do one without the other. So I just wanna tell you guys to, you know, take school serious, because that's gonna help you be a better football player. That's gonna help you reach your fullest potential. That's gonna help you go far in life. It's gonna help you get to the NFL if that's what you wanna do. It's gonna help you be a lawyer if you wanna be a lawyer, or a doctor. It ain't just football. You know, it's other things in life that you could do to be successful other than play football. You know, football is what I wanted to do. Football was my calling, you know, from God. And that was my passion. That was what I was passionate about. And if you want to be a successful athlete or a successful basketball, football player, shouldn't nobody have to tell you to train, to run, to jump, to be on time, be respectful, to listen. All those things, it should be things that you should want to do. You know, my mom didn't have to tell me to go to practice, go train. Sometimes when I was bored, I'd go to the park, Westside Park. It wasn't no turf back then. It was a dirt field, and it wasn't no gates around it either. So I used to go and run on my own and run hills and do different, jump over garbage cans back and forth. I didn't really know where I was going, but I knew I was going to be good at whatever I was doing. And, if you want to be great at something, you got to consistently do that on the regular. You got to don't worry. And another thing is, I never really cared what my friends was. I had friends, some was into whatever they was into, and some was doing what I was doing. But at the end of the day, I knew what I wanted to do. And I knew what was right, and I knew what was wrong. So at the end of the day, you gotta have a mind of your own. It's tough out here, and it's bigger than just mom and dad. It's a village. It's the coaches, it's the teachers, all of those people that's in your life. They all, you know, like mentors and parents and stuff like that. So everything they trying to give you is to be successful. So don't be, you know, just let them do their job, pretty much. And all my teachers out there, I see a lot of teachers. I see Ms. Lutz, I see Ms. Tyndall, I see Ms. Mosby, I see Ms. Waddell, I see Ms. Brown, I see Mr. Brown, I see Ms. Muhammad. And if I forgot your name or if I, I'm sorry, it's a lot of stuff going through my head. But I see a lot of mentors and people that dealt with me one-on-one. I appreciate y'all for being patient because I turned out very well. I'm gonna share a couple things that my mom taught me growing up and that I love her and thank her for. My mom ain't never let me quit nothing I ever start. She never let me quit nothing in life. And she told me, she said, if you start it, you gotta finish it. And there's been times in my life that I wanted to quit or I felt as though this too hard and I'm gonna go over here and do this. She told me that she said, if you run now, you're going to be running for the rest of your life. So my mom was a track star, and she had an athletic background. And
good. Y'all can clap. Good.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I'm long-winded. It wasn't supposed to be this long. My mom never let me quit anything. Another thing, my mom raised four boys. So I got three brothers. I got James, Darius, and the youngest one is Luther. And she never let me quit anything. But not only that, my mom was a school teacher in the city of Newark and still is in coaching track. And my mom instilled work ethic in me. She never let me quit. And she always was hard on me about academics. And it's tough being, number one, it's tough raising four boys in the city of Newark. And number two, and most teachers go through this that got kids, when you in school, whether you substitute in teaching or whatever you're doing in the school system, you teaching, you deal with those kids, and then you got to come home and deal with your own kids. It's a lot. And I didn't understand that. So now, I'm matured, and I'm a grown man, and I'm way more wiser than I was back then. But I appreciate you, Mom, for sticking by my side through the good, bad, and instilling, just never quitting. So my mom is still, never to quit in me, and everything else became easy because the hardest part to anything I ever did in life and to this day is showing up. If I show up, I'm from Newark. I got that dog in me. I'ma smash whatever. Like, if I show up, damn, my back hurt. No, if I show up, I already know I'm going to rise to the top. I'm going to rise to the occasion, no matter what it is. So I just appreciate you, Mom. Like, when I went to Don Bosco Prep, you didn't have the funds to pay the tuition. I think the tuition might have been $15,000, $16,000 a year. My mom couldn't afford that. But I told my mom, I'm going to figure it out. I got this. Because I knew that I had work ethic, I knew I was talented, and I knew that was going, dig my path and get me to where I'm at today. So when I went to Don Bosco Prep, it was probably one of the hardest things I experienced in my life because, and as a coach, if anybody ever coached sports in here, in the summertime, depends on where you're from or, depends on the city. It's hard to get kids to show up in the summertime to train. It's really, really, really hard. So I was used to, my summertime, I came and I worked, I came to work out and stuff like that. But also, I wanted to spend time with my friends and I wanted to do other things, So when I got to Don Bosco Prep, it was a different type of summer training. And it was the hardest thing I ever did in my life. And every day, I literally thought I was going to pass out. and then I had to eat different and stuff like that. But my mom, she knew what I needed and stuff like that, and she gave me everything I needed. But anyway, on a car ride home, I was like, Mom, you know, I want to go to Patterson Catholic, and I want to do this, and I want to do that. And she looked at me like, if you go to Patterson Catholic, it's going to be the same thing. So she was like, it ain't no need to quit or to do that. She literally, so I was like, all right, I can't get out of this. I thought I could finagle my way out of it. I was like, all right, cool. If I could go to this school and I could do this. But she would not let me quit. She would not let me quit. And as an athlete, you always hit a wall. You're going to hit a wall somewhere in your career. You're going to hit that wall. Let me explain something to you. If you could bust through that wall, it's over. It's over. Because you've been there before. You felt what the burn for, like, whatever there is that hurt. It's going to be successful, is pain come with that. And you got to be able to endure and be able to, you know, you got to be able to endure that pain. And if you can endure that pain, eventually it doesn't feel like pain. It feels like just a normal day, you know. So you got to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. That's what you got to do to the young men that's in here and to everybody. These principles apply not to only young athletes. These are principles that apply to life in general. You know, and everybody go through hardship. Everybody hit walls and stuff like that. I still listen to my son every single day. You know why? Because we got social media. We got social media. So people see things on social media and stuff like that, and they see all the successful superstar athletes and stuff like that, and just think you could just go out there and just it magically happens. That's not how it go. That's just not how it go. You have to put in that pain. You have to put in that work on a consistent basis. You got to make daily deposits. You got to. And that's the only way you're going to reach the levels that you want to reach. You know, this is my eighth season in the NFL, and I train every single day. I don't post this. I used to post and do this and do that, but it ain't about that. It ain't about that. It's stay ready so you ain't got to get ready, you know? So when that opportunity come, it's over. I'm going to do what I need to do. And there's rewards that come with that. You know, we all like nice things. We all want to be successful. We all want to travel. But we don't want to put the work in. So you got to put that work in. You have to put the work in. Nothing magically going to fall on your lap. It's just not. Like, people look up to certain people and it's like, oh, that dude and this, that. I could bet my last dime that dude worked every single day on a different level. So at the end of the day, there's no shortcuts, there's no ways around it. You have to put the work in. You have to put the grind in. And I promise you, before you look up, it's gonna be nice. You get to enjoy your future fruits of your labor. And then you go back to work. Like, there's nobody on this stage, and you know, everybody with suit and ties and all these successful people that's in this room, they put that work in. Yeah, we travel. Yeah, we have fun. But at the end of the day, you still got to put the work in. And we work on vacation, too. So at the end of the day, to be honest with you, you can't duck it. It don't stop. It do not stop. It does not stop. So if I can leave y'all with anything, you got to put the work in. You got to put the work in. You can't duck it. And at the end of the day, don't get caught up into, oh, this person doing that and that person do that. Worry about yourself. Worry about what you got going on, you know? Worry about your journey. I never ever, you know, I seen people that was doing some great things and I was like, wow, that's dope. But I always worried about what Al-Qaeda Muhammad had going on and what I wanted to do and how I wanted to do it and how I wanted to accomplish it. And sometimes it bit me in my butt, and a lot of other times, though, it worked out. You know, I always had my own plan, and I had my own way of doing it and stuff like that. But the biggest thing I had was work ethic, and I was always consistent. So no matter what different trials and tribulations I was going through personally, I made sure I kept the main thing the main thing. So make sure y'all keep the main thing the main thing, and you'll reach whatever goals and whatever accomplishments you want to reach in life. Thank you. Everybody have a blessed one.
Thankful to have him as a father. You know, he's the best. He's the best, you know. I watch him every day. I study him. I look up to him. He give me grace. I give him grace. I tell him when he wrong. He tell me when he wrong. He's an amazing father, you know. I just be grateful because a lot of kids don't have, you know, fathers that they can look up to, you know.
My name is Michelle Epps. I'm Al Qadim Muhammad's mom. I am so proud of my son. My son knew at an early age that he was set up for greatness, because I could go back to Paramus Catholic when he first went there, and I looked at him and I said, well, how are we going to pay for Paramus Catholic? I'm a substitute teacher. He said, God going to make a way. And God has made a way. Wimberly looked at him. Coach Wimberly looked at him and just gave him the athletic application and told me, bring him back tomorrow. Don Bosco was the same way. The Don Bosco's coaches came out to the park. They told him to move this way, to move that way. I didn't know what they were doing, but it was so amazing to me. They said, bring him with his cliques. Bring him to practice the next day. So Al Qadim was so persistent when he talked about how hard work it was. I remember he wanted this helmet that Don Bosco was giving out. And this helmet was a new helmet with 30 little squares in it. So he wanted this helmet, but they made him work for his helmet. So the day he got his helmet, he came home, Mom, I got my Don Bosco helmet. He was so elated. So I had so many good times with my son, even going to the U.S. Army Bowl game. He had scored, sack in the Army Bowl game, and the East Coast won the Army Bowl game that year. So I was very proud of him. He had every school in the country, every school in the United States looking after him. So he knew what he wanted, and he drove and went after whatever he wanted. And God was first in our life. So put God first, hard work and dedication. Anyone's child can make and be successful in whatever their dreams are, whether it's football, whether it's a lawyer, whether it's a doctor, whether it's a teacher, whatever your desire is, you have to work for it. As long as you put in the work, you will achieve it. Everyone have a blessed day.